Let me go boost it to
high def quality.
We go turn on the. You can see the stream right there.
That's a huge delay on that thing. You're still not up there, Mark. There you go.
It's getting processed. It's getting pushed up. It's got to be pulled back
in. Actually, you up there.
It's making a big loop.
Place lineup.
Yes, he's gonna walk around.
Okay.
Keep popping, sir, then it's not receiving enough data.
What? What's not receiving enough?
It's just not receiving enough data. It went away again. I'm gonna switch the next time I'm gonna switch the I'm gonna get newer network cable.
Oh, is there any other network cable then?
Mm-hmm. No.
Well, how is the shot?
It's really weird. Step out more. This thing broke.
Hmm?
This thing broke, gotta get a new one.
What do you mean it broke?
Yes.
Oh, new shit. How'd that happen?
It's crazy. Oh, that's good. That's even.
There's a bit of a lag. Well, Jesse definitely got it cold in her, that's for sure. Her freezing my ass up.
Gotta turn the streaming to more. We gotta turn that to private.
I'll keep my mouth shut. Why did it run? It's 3 minutes after it went started. We can stop streaming?
No, we could just.
Where is it? It's alright, leave it live, man.
Leave it live.
Alright. Nobody connected anyways right now, is there?
Yeah, nobody knows. It's not advertised.
Right. So how are you going to get the link out?
To who?
I don't know. Oh, you're just recording it.
We recorded it. What's good, it just stay on there, and then when I could just give them the link.
Okay.
I could edit it, just chop the front, chop the back, and save that on YouTube as well, and then send the link. They could download it themselves.
There you
and
go.
Card loved that. Not only that, it's the same way as media site.
Yeah.
What she does sometimes is that people who want to see the live lecture, we could send them an active link. Mm-hmm. And we set it up where it's unlisted and private. Only people with the link could view it. So, she tried like 75 bucks. So I don't feel bad when we charge you like 200, 300 for this thing. Is it crooked, Mark?
Hmm?
I'm gonna go through the slide to see how it look.
Testing 1, 2. Testing. Welcome. That's low.
No, that sounds good.
Sound good?
Yeah, it sounds good.
He's a soft spoken man.
Testing.
Testing 1, 2. Testing. Welcome.
Yeah, that came out good. I still think we need a patch audio to go from the system back to the camera, but I mean, it sounds a little boomy, but
testing. What, I think I have to move the camera up front a bit too. Testing. Welcome. Testing.
That's good. That's not too bad. It's cool, right? The camera's cooking,
right?
Yes. Okay, that's good enough. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's definitely good enough.
People should start showing up in about 10 minutes.
You might want to get the camera pushed a little further in.
You hear that buzz, Mark?
That's from the lights. That's from those lights up there.
Which lights?
The stage lights. Yeah, it's coming from the transformers up there in the stage lights.
Testing.
Receiving data from your coder. Your hiccup, but now it's back. Holy
God. It's buffering again.
Would we have time to double check those two ports? You said it was kicking at 600 meg?
To do with a tricorder or the tricaster, personally, it was hiccuping. But yeah, we're offline now. Looks like
it's good now.
No, we're offline. It says the health is good, but I got that buffering. looks like it's good. We're, what's funny is the preview view is good. We're doing good on the preview side, but on the public view, it's hung.
So what's going out is hung.
No, hey, look, I mean, this is...
It's preview.
This is what you were doing earlier, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Is that before I moved the shot?
That's the new shot. You know?
I guess okay. So.
Yeah, the public.
Public spec one. Oh, shoot. Let's shoot the TriCaster.
No, it's working. Yeah, it's streaming. That's what this is coming from. I mean, the preview stream is working.
Do you think it's the cable?
No. Says we got a kid streaming. This is paused. Thank you.
some of the checking students in?
That's what I'm just texting her.
I'm doing well, how are you?
Oh.
Everybody, to the 15th annual symposium here at the Wilkes Honors College of Florida Atlantic University. I'm Dr. Timothy Stegega. I'm the Chair of Social Sciences and Humanities here. And this is our Chastain Lecture. And our speaker today will be Dr. Frank Heiler. I'll tell you a little bit about Frank. And then what we'll do is he'll speak for 40, 45 minutes. Leave a little time for you who have questions, so you can have a little give and take at the end, and we'll call it a day after that. Frank, yes?
Step back just a bit, evidently.
Step back.
There we go.
I make that go away. Is that better? I tell you what, I'm just going to turn it off and yell.
Feedback, yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yeah. Awesome.
So Frank is a tenured full professor of emergency in North Carolina. Where he got his PhD and his master's in public health. He did did his residency from there in Albuquerque, and he's been a practicing ER doctor for 20 years at the Level 1 Trauma Center at the University of New Mexico, which serves a very diverse underserved population. That's the medical side of Frank Cotton. On the humanities side, his poetry has been published in the Atlantic Monthly and Poetry. He's a regular contributor to Vice and New York Daily News on issues of medicine and society. He has published two novels, The Laws of Invisible Things and Right of Thirst, and recently a new novella called The Castaway. I recommend that one, it's a little shorter. And his first book of short stories, actually, which sort of launched his writing career, was called The Blood of Strangers. And those of you who were there last night maybe caught a little snippet of that as you read one story from that. I met Frank back in Chapel Hill when I was a graduate student at UNC and he was a medical student. We spent many hours back in those days talking about really important issues in medicine and society, like whether or not we had enough money to buy good beer that weekend. Again. But Frank's parents were international teachers. He grew up spending his childhood years in Brazil, Iran, Japan, and other places around the world. And those are experiences that still inform and frame his perspective on how what he writes about and how he thinks. I've been honored to read and comment on some of his books over the years. Luckily for him, he didn't take any of my advice, but I have also enjoyed the benefit of his insights on some of my own work. Today, Frank is going to talk about a topic that's close to his heart, the intersection of medicine, social science, and the humanities. Frank was a writer long before he was a doctor, really, and some of his patients wish he kept it that way, but he's actually good at both. And I'm thrilled to invite him today. Please help me in welcoming Frank Cotton.
So I want to talk about that a little bit directly today. So I'm going to start this talk with a couple cases, and that's how we usually start talks in medicine, with case histories. So, patient number one. So you're working in the emergency room. Ambulance comes in, and the paramedics tell you, 55-year-old woman, chest pain, that's all you know. You walk into the room, and you see this. These are her vital signs. So, blood pressure of 90 over 60, oxygen level of 90% on 100% oxygen. So we'll talk a little bit about give and take stuff, but basically that means her blood pressure is low, and she's not breathing well. So her oxygen level and her blood pressure are low. So, you walk into the room, what do you see? She's gasping, she's clutching her chest, she's cursing at everybody, she's drunk, she smells like cigarette smoke, and the paramedics say, you know, she called us because she was having chest pain, but we really can't tell what's wrong with her. And then the paramedic hands me an EKG. So this is her EKG, and EKGs are kind of complicated and hard to read. They're really just pattern recognition. They actually look harder than they are. You just get used to seeing them. And what you're seeing here, you see how you look at this segment lines up with the rest of it, right in there? That's normal. And right here is a heart attack. A really big heart attack, actually. this is a normal EKG. We were looking before. I know this is kind of hard to see on the screen like this, but this is hers. Big heart attack, right here. So you know right away this woman's having a really bad problem. What'd she have? She has a heart attack in the distribution of the right coronary artery. So, for those of you who've taken anatomy, or about to take anatomy, right coronary artery is what comes off the side of the heart, supplies this part of the heart, the underside of the heart, and she's having a heart attack in it. So I'll talk a little bit about what a heart attack is, but this is her chest x-ray. This is a normal chest x-ray. So you guys, can you see this? Can you see that reasonably well?
Yeah.
So you see your size of her heart, you see your lungs, or these are lungs, both sides. This is the heart right here. That's a normal chest x-ray. This is her chest x-ray. Can you see a difference? Yeah? So what do you see? Her heart's really big. That means her heart's swollen, kind of bam. And this is all fluid in her lungs. This means her heart's failing. So these are very ominous signs. This is about somebody who's about, frankly, to die. So what do you do? The emergency room. Call the cardiologist, right? I mean, that's what we do in emergency room a lot. Call the cardiologist, call the surgeon. And the cardiologist on the phone says, I know her. I just put a stent in her. Is she taking her medicine? Is she taking her plaques? So any guesses as to whether she's taking her medicine? Okay. He just put a stent. The cardiologist just put a stent in Mrs. Smith. This is a stent. It costs $7,000. It's about, or more, it's about this long. I mean, it looks like the end of a straw. It's this tiny little thing that they thread up, put into your blood vessels around your heart, open up a blockage, and leave in place. And it's kind of this wonder of modern technology. That's what a stent is. When you get a stent, you have to take medications, typically this one, Plavix, for months. And it's a blood thinner. And so it helps thin the blood so you don't have a clot form around the stent. It causes another even worse heart attack. It costs $4 a pill. That was a couple years ago. It's probably more now. So Mrs. Smith, she's diabetic, risk factor for heart disease. She has hypertension, high blood pressure. She's a heavy smoker. She's mentally ill. She does a lot of drugs. She lives in shelters. She has really bad heart disease. And last but not least, she's very difficult to deal with. She's cursing at us, spitting at us, not cooperating with the staff, the nurses. And nobody wants to take care of her as a result because she's difficult. Not her fault. She's mentally ill. This is not something that's conscious. Okay, so this is the cath lab. Cardiac catheterization laboratory. Again, a wonder of modern technology. They take a catheter and they thread it up right by your heart. They squirt dye into your blood and you can see the exact images of the coronary vasculature. So here, if you remember that slide I showed earlier, is the right coronary artery of a normal person. It's a cath lab image. Coming down, you see it goes all the way down here. Here is the right coronary artery in her. Comes down, comes down, comes down, stops. Right? So that place where it stops is where the blood supply to this whole area of the heart stops. And so there's a clot that's formed right here. Everything below this is dying. That's what a heart attack is. This is Smith. So she's in the hospital for months. She generated over $1 million in medical bills that the state of New Mexico paid for. She had a very badly damaged heart. And then after all was said and done, she got sent home again. It was exactly the same situation she had been in before with some vouchers for Plavix again. So no change, except that she almost died and spent months in the hospital and generated enormous expenses, and then was sent back to the street. Okay, that's Mrs. Smith. The Garcia. Now, I've changed these names, incidentally, but these are all patients that I've seen. Their names are different. I've disguised identities. This is Ms. Garcia. She's 30 years old. She has two young kids. And she went to a private hospital in Albuquerque with really severe flank pain and was diagnosed with a kidney stone. And she had a kidney stone that was actually infected, and that's a dangerous thing. When you have a kidney stone with an infection on top of it, that's dangerous. That can, people can get really sick from that. So the treatment for that is what's called an emergency nephrostomy tube. So here, if you look at her, this is a CAT scan. This is a kind of normal looking kidney. Can you see the size? This is her other kidney. So normal looking kidney, fat, swollen kidney, because it's plugged up from kidney stone downstream. You don't see. Okay, so a nephrostomy tube. That's what a nephrostomy tube is. You take a needle, you stick it in the kidney, the tube comes out, you hook the tube to a bag, and the urine drains out of the kidney into the bag. And decompresses the kidney, protects the kidney for a while, you don't have to deal with kidney stone like that. So that's what a nephrostomy tube is. Okay, this is her nephrostomy tube. She gave me permission to take this photograph. This nephrostomy tube has been in there for 3 weeks. Usually they're done, they're in for a day or two. Here's a nephrostomy tube. Right here, you can sort of see it. Yeah, you can, these CAT scan, what this CAT scan looks like, and this is the kidney with the nephrostomy tube. So, she continued to work during this whole time as a nurse's aide. So she's actually working in healthcare, taking care of people who often have less worse problems than she does. She has insurance. Her policy covered 75% of the bill, but that extra 25% of the bill. It's too much for her. It's a couple of thousands of dollars. She couldn't pay it. So the private practice urologist said, all right, go to the public hospital. See you later. If you get the money, call me. So she comes to the emergency room, worsening pain, difficulty urinating, waits 9 hours in the ER, waits another 5 hours for urology. This is, again, a woman with two young children and a full-time job. Additional bill, $4,000. That's just for that visit when I saw her. And extra risks associated with this are another CAT scan. So CAT scans in young people particularly are not good. They give you radiation. You want to avoid them because they slightly risk increase your lifetime cancer risk. Not a lot, but just a little bit. It's enough that you don't want, like to do them. And then urology consultation. So, doctors in private practice usually won't accept patients unless they have cash up front or good insurance. Very common, particularly among specialists, but really all private physicians. This is a very common thing. Okay, patient number three. So, 55-year-old woman, chest pain, can't really describe it very well. Sort of under her chab bay. She's driving across the country to see her sister. She had lost her house. Almost lost her house. She had lost her job and was at risk for losing her house. She is diabetic, which is a risk factor for heart trouble. High blood pressure, also a risk factor for heart trouble, and a family history of heart trouble. So she has risk factors for heart trouble. But she looks fine. She just had this chest discomfort. And when she was concerned enough about it, she came to the nurse. So this is her EKG. Any guesses? Normal, abnormal? Normal, right, exactly. Normal EKG. Guess that's right. Normal, again. And her blood work is all normal, too. But she's got all these cardiac risk factors, right? You know that she has a risk for having heart trouble. So causes of death in the United States. Every ER doctor knows this. You can see heart attacks, chest pain, very high. Always high risk when you see someone who has that complaint. When you're trying to take care of them, you don't make the right decisions for them. Mrs. Jones, this is what she says. I've lost my job. I'm in stress. Do you think this all might be stress? Do you think I'm just stressed out? So, what do I do? What do I do in that situation? What's the right thing?
Observe.
What's that?
Observe her overnight.
Yeah, okay. So discharge her with reassurance.
Yeah.
Probably get away with it, right? She's probably not having a heart attack. Try to do an outpatient arranged follow-up or something in Albuquerque, but she's driving across town, doesn't have much money, doesn't have a doctor in town, doesn't have insurance. Watch overnight. That was someone's. These are decisions I'm trying to make. I don't have all the information. The tests we have are imperfect and inaccurate, which is true. Much of the time, we don't have enough information. So I left it up to her, discussed this all with her, and she said, I'm worried about this. My father died when he was only a little older than I am from a heart attack, and I think I better be sure. So, good news. After all the observation, the stress test, the blood work, she did not have heart disease. It was stress. But it cost $10,000 to find that out. And that was the bill she got, which took me a long time to figure out, actually, because I had to trace it down, track down all the different bills she was getting. It was amazing how many different bills she got from different parts of the hospital. Anyway, they all added up to that $10,000. So, are these scientific questions and problems? That's the question. This is ego reading. Actually, it's not. This is but sometimes it goes like that. So, medicine doesn't even really ask these kinds of questions. We don't spend any time talking about this sort of thing in the clinical world as doctors or nurses or as other people in the medical system. Don't even ask these questions. But we do answer them. And we answer the questions every day. So, we just want to review a couple of the answers. So, Mrs. Smith, okay, we're going to spend $1 million. We're going to give you the latest in cardiac treatment. And then we'll send you back to the street without any help or any psychiatrist or anything. And hope this doesn't happen again. Ms. Garcia, we're going to let you walk around for 3 weeks with this thing hanging out of your back, taking care of your kids and your job, having going to work. Charge you extra money, increase your lifetime cancer risk because you didn't have that 25% up front. And then Mrs. Jones, $10,000 of additional bills on top of our already stressed financial system. First person to tell her that she was stressed out, not having a heart attack. So, point is that these answers that we come up with are often irrational. They make no sense, often. And they also escape scrutiny. We don't tend to discuss these issues quite like this or examine them carefully. So recent decades, U.S. healthcare industry treated the uninsured and the underinsured very badly, brutally. Costs are unsustainable. Costs are ballooning, and this is beyond the scope of this talk. The struggle over healthcare in the public eye. So if you talk about, if you look at the news, you'll see that there's been a lot of stuff about the Affordable Care Act and the repeal of the Affordable Care Act and on. This has been going on for years. Really a struggle about value systems, struggle about power, about money. A lot of things that are being struggled about with healthcare as a kind of a football that's being thrown around. And these are ultimately humanistic, whatever your positions may be, humanistic rather than scientific questions, and that's one of the points. So, symptom for disease, this is a gurney, one of our gurneys, kind of a crappy gurney actually. When you step on it, they're not really very good gurneys. $7,000, that's how much this gurney costs. This is the Tatanano, cheapest car in the world, under $2,000. This has a motor, an engine, windows and so on. It's a lot cheaper than the gurney. Lack of health insurance, almost 50,000 deaths, about 45,000 deaths a year in the United States is associated with this. Number six on the disease list. So, just did ahead of accidents, which is amazing. Okay, so what does this have to do with the humanities and medicine? You have to guess, this is the humanities, and this is medicine. And you could also say, that's the humanities and that's some of the sciences, too, because it often feels that way, at least in the medical center. The definition of the humanities and medicine is very broad. It includes, as best I can tell, kind of everything that is in science. And that seems to be one of the, but nonetheless, it talks about literature, philosophy, ethics, religion, the kinds of things that no one wants to leave anybody out, so they don't tend to narrow these definitions very carefully. So this is a quote from Carlos Goyendas. So the point about broad definitions, when you talk about the humanities in a sweeping kind of way, is you have ill-defined boundaries. It's hard to define the terms of the debate. It's hard to say which area of the humanities you mean when you're talking about something. Standards vary widely. There's unclear practical application. All of these are problems when you start talking about the humanities and medicine or how they apply to science. And the risk of self-indulgence and irrelevance is real. Now, a lot of you guys are probably too young to remember Stuart Smalley on Saturday Night Live. But sort of this mutual admiration society, oh, you're great, no, I'm great, oh, you're good enough, oh, you know, oh, wonderful. And sometimes, this comes a little close to home when we're talking about these issues. The point is that many of the most relevant questions in our lives, and in our and that we ask ourselves and each other, can't be answered empirically. And so, in professional forms, and particularly in medicine and also in the sciences, we tend to just kind of pretend that they're not there, because it's not easy to come up with an answer. And also, there are social values as well. So, evidence-based medicine. Doctors do this all the time, so do scientists. Show me the data. That's a common phrase you hear. Show me the data. I want to know what this, before you make an argument, give me the reasons why I should believe you or not believe you. And the idea behind this is rigor. And it is a form of rigor. It's a quantitative analysis. That's what rigor typically implies. Now, skip over the fact that the data are often not as pure. They're often biased in different ways. I don't want to focus on that too much. So what does rigor in the humanities ask for? So it asks for intellectual rigor, or intellectual engagement, attention. It also asks for emotional and aesthetic engagement. It asks you to be involved and put yourself emotionally into a discussion. To be a visceral participant. So, talk a little bit about medical culture. I think this applies to a lot of quantitative disciplines as well, not just medicine, but conformity and achievement. In other words, you work really hard within a system, and you do really well following the rules, and you're really good at following the rules, and really disciplined and driven to follow the rules and excel within those rules. That describes a lot of medical culture. So, medical culture disproportionately values quantitative intellect. Not that quantitative intellect's not important, but as I've gotten older, it's become clear to me that it's not as important as I used to think it was. Medical culture is too comfortable with clinical distance. So, this graph is survival curves for cancers, a large number of cancers. And the stories within these survival curves are horrific. They're unbelievable. There's thousands and thousands of people going through stuff here. medicine is comfortable with the graphs, but not necessarily delving farther than that, at least in emotional terms. There's a lot of reasons for this. Doctors get pretty defensive pretty quickly a lot of the time. It speaks to insecurities and question them. No, not everybody, of course, but when people feel emotionally vulnerable, they feel uncomfortable. And particularly for people who've been rewarded and doing well and keeping everything under control, that's not a place they want to be in, typically. So, medicine is also contemptuous of weakness. And in the same way, it's some ways like the military. The parallels between the military and medicine definitely exist. The hierarchy, the contempt for weakness, the singling out people who don't seem like they're strong as the rest of them. So, and the conformity that people try to sort of force themselves to be in a certain way or not express themselves are very similar. There are good reasons for this. This is not all bad. So clinical distance, self-protective. You see stuff that really no normal person would really want to see. And the way you get through that is you develop your natural defense mechanisms to step away and not be moved, not be touched by anything. That happens very easily, very naturally. It's actually not hard. It's a natural reflex that we all do. The challenge is to find a way back from that. So, most in medicine are competitive people. They're selected for their competitive natures and their work ethic and their reluctance to admit vulnerability. So you are in a selected population from the start. Okay, so empiricism is too often both exculpatory and avoidant. And what I mean by that is empiricism allows you to not confront some of the questions that are there, that you know are there, that nonetheless make the work either meaningful or distressing or satisfying. When you cling to empiricism, you don't ask those larger questions, and you lose something as a result of that. Is this rigorous? That's the question. If you're going to just ask questions that you can answer with data, are you really asking rigorous questions? So empathy, the study of the humanities, make you nicer. And that's one of the things people hear a lot about, right? Talk a lot about being nicer. Read stories, walk in someone's shoes, you're kinder to them. How about Mrs. Smith? How hard is it to empathize with Mrs. Smith, or is it realistic to empathize with her, to walk in her shoes, to know what it's like to be her? Anybody? For me, it's very hard. It's very hard for you to understand or even imagine what it would be like to be Mrs. Smith. How about Ms. Garcia? To me, that's easier. And Mrs. Jones, easier stuff. The point is that empathy is unpredictable, it's unreliable, as it shouldn't necessarily guide what we do. So heresy, empathy and insight, empathy are not the same. We need to do the job anyway. So, point, humanities are not about making people nicer. It's not simply about cultivating empathy. Now, no one's gonna mind if it does that, if it helps. But I think it's a misnomer to state that as the primary reason for thinking about humanistic questions in medical and scientific worlds. Principles of bioethics. So if you haven't heard about this, if you're doing pre-med stuff, you will hear about this, and you'll hear a lot about it. But autonomy is an important consent. Someone has the right to make their own mind. Non-malfeasance, do no harm, so don't do bad stuff. Beneficence, do good. And then justice, be fair to all. So if you think back on those cases, how many cases have we in all of these apply to Ms. Jones, Ms. Smith, and Ms. Garcia? That's a topic for another subject, but I think you can see that not all of them do. All of the institutional decisions in healthcare, I shouldn't say all, virtually all, are financially driven around payment, around very various forms of commerce. It's not always bad. I'm just saying, in the U.S., the ethics of healthcare have been, and this is one of the more interesting things to me, it's always been imposed from outside. So Medicaid, Medicare, Affordable Care Act, the repeal of Affordable Care Act, malpractice litigation, a tort system where you say if a doctor makes a mistake, causes damages, they're entitled to, the patient's entitled to sue them to recover those damages. All of that has been imposed from beyond the medical world, from outside of science, outside of medicine, by larger social, by larger society. This is an example of a law. It says if you go to the emergency room, we won't force you to pay the bill or show us you can pay the bill before we'll see you. You get to be seen. You'll get a bill later, but you won't be turned away at the door. It's an important law, and it only was put in place in 1986. So, healthcare debate. This is going on, right? This is, we're reading about this still. Okay. These are not questions that have been settled or answered. And where are the doctors in all these debates? And well, I don't mean just doctors, but doctors are convenient. And the answer is that they really mostly absolve themselves of discussing these things, or weighing in one way or the other. They tend to sit on the fence, not talk about it, not weigh in. Whatever their views may be. So to recap, humanistic argument is viewed with suspicion in medicine, and comfort, familiarity with humanistic argument is something that is limited. I mean, doctors don't like talking about the stuff, they're not used to it, they're uncomfortable talking about it, and they're reluctant to do so. They also don't have cultural permission to do so. Within the medical world and within the scientific communities, often talking about things like emotional expression is seen as sort of flawed. Seen as a little bit of weakness. So there's still pretty deep biases against talking about some of the things that make medicine so powerful. And humanistic systems are what created most of our healthcare systems, humanistic principles rather. So how we deliver healthcare based on humanism, as much as it is science, even more so. So take home message, at their best, the humanities encourage self-reflection. They encourage a different sort of thought, moral argument, synthesis, in ways that the sciences don't formally do. Now, a lot of these issues are still implicit within any scientific activity, but they're not addressed, typically. So, the humanities can help us be more vigilant. They can help us be more self-aware. They remind us of the stakes that inform science, and all science. And that we're talking about, this little photo boy has been in leukemia. This is chemotherapy. The stakes are high, they're real, these questions are real. Ask us to do better, aspire us to be better angels of our nature. It's an important thing. In any kind of work, it's hard to kind of have a larger, bigger vision, you're working for something better. So back to Mrs. Smith. So Mrs. Smith, the unpleasant patient, she's the one who kind of reflects who we are when we look at her. How our healthcare system works and how we apply the medical technology and knowledge to our social values. I think mistakes that people sometimes make is they think that these are antithetical as opposed to complementary. And to me, they're complementary. So finally, from E.O. Wilson, famous writer and scientist, drowning in information, starving in wisdom, the world henceforth will be run by synthesizers, people able to put together the right information at the right time, think critically about it, and make important choices wisely. So, people with discernment, who can look beyond and have some wisdom. Stories have power. So this is Ann Garcia back at home with her family after her kidney stone. And finally, we should tell them. So that is all I have for you guys. Except I'm hoping you'll description. You need that. I mean, you really do need it. But I think what doctors should be encouraged, not just doctors, anyone that works in these kinds of environments, by no means just doctors, that a little more permission to reveal the effects and to think about some of the effects of this. Because a lot of people feel this, they just internalize it. I mean, many. It's a very repressed world where people don't talk about things. But when things come up and they do feel they have permission to do so, what comes out is quite often quite powerful and quite amazing, actually, even from unexpected sources. So people you wouldn't expect to have these sorts of thoughts and so on do, and just become very good at hiding them. So part of it, I think, is to do with cultural permission, a little bit of cultural permission. And I think another part of it is to remind people that confronting these questions is not a weakness, or attempting to.
How do you think this debate is being portrayed, like in television shows? Because, like, I've been thinking about, like, House and, like, General Hospital and stuff like that, and they kind of raise those kind of questions. Where do you step back? Do you take emotional? Do you think that's making any sort of statements, or is just good TV?
If I had to say, I'd say it's good TV. Now, not that I don't like, the question is, how do shows like House and General Hospital address these kind of questions, and are they real, are they good TV? And I think, yeah, maybe there's some truth. I'm not saying that there's no truth to any of this, but first and foremost, they're good TV. I like the shows too, so that's not, this is not a criticism. Yeah.
I work in kind of public health, epidemiology stuff, uh-huh. And school thinking that given the opportunity, people would kind of respond to incentives and do things that are better for them when given the opportunity. And a lot of times they don't.
Yes.
A lot of times they will choose the wrong thing for their own health and the health around them, the people their health around them. So in those situations, how could the humanities, I guess, provide someone who would normally just give the medicine and let them walk out the door? Like, how would the humanities
Well, I think that's a very good question. How do the humanities change? And, you know, how practical are any specific humanistic things? And that's a very valid question. I guess one of the things I would think about when you talk about incentives is, what are they incentivized to do? What do they want to do? So you say, well, clearly they should be taking care of themselves better, but maybe they really want to drink, you know, or maybe. Or maybe they're in substance, they have problems with substance abuse. I mean, I'm just saying, different incentives depending on your perspective. What we think seems very clear to someone on the other side who is struggling with various issues may not be. They don't want to do the same thing that we do. I don't know. I don't think there's an easy answer to that, but it is absolutely true. The amount of sort of self-destruction in various ways that you see over and over again is hard to understand. Hard to understand as a caregiver, certainly.
You spoke a little bit about evidence-based medicine and something uh-huh. I learned with Dr. Kennedy when I took my class. But and you also said how a lot of the evidence that's actually used, you know, to make a diagnosis is actually biased. So how would you develop a system to train up-and-coming doctors that sort of, you know, has actual evidence being used to make diagnoses, but that also includes this sort of humanistic views in their training?
Right. Well, I think I don't want to say all evidence is biased. I'm saying some evidence. Some evidence is. A lot of evidence is not biased. A lot of evidence is good science. when we read evidence as we're largely taking that evidence as a kind of faith. We read a study and we assume that that is right because it's in the New England Journal of Medicine and it seems well designed. But we're really not in a position most of the time to make a true discernment based on our medical knowledge. And this is true for many areas of specialized knowledge. Knowledge is passed along in a way, in somewhat cultural ways. Like we agree with, we understand New England Journal of Medicine say is the top medical journal, one of them, and the studies that get published there must have been rigorously designed. And so when we read something in New England Journal, we say, okay, that's probably true. But we don't really have the ability to just make up our own minds on our own. So a lot of what we assume and trust in science is not purely rational, it's cultural. I don't know if I answered part of your question, but.
Do you think other healthcare professionals like nurses and PAs have more open culture towards addressing these humanitarian questions?
I think they do, actually. I think nurses are nursing culture, and in terms of mid-levels, I'm not so certain, but I think there are distinct differences between physician culture and nursing culture, which is actually another topic that's sort of interesting, particularly people who are part of hospitals. I think there is a little difference. And I think you probably would find more openness among nurses to this sort of thing. Well, I mean, I have my suspicions about why that might be so. The reason that term has come around just in the last few years, never used to be the case, and the ostensible formal justification for it is to say, well, we have a lot of mid-level providers, we have nurse practitioners and physician's assistants, therefore, if we're going to talk about people who are giving healthcare, we should include everybody and put them into a single category, which is healthcare provider. Now, there's nothing wrong with being a healthcare provider, but really, I strongly suspect that a lot of this has to do with the power struggle between the corporate world and organized medicine and doctors, which doctors have largely lost. So 30 or 40 years ago, doctors were more preeminent, relatively speaking, in the medical world, in terms of power in that world. That power has shifted quite significantly, and not always for the worse. I'm not saying that this is always just a bad thing. I'm just saying that medicine has become increasingly corporate and increasingly views everybody who works in it as an employee. And this is the kind of rhetoric that comes out of that, that we're all employees and we're all working for a larger entity that will. Does that?
Yeah, it does. And it makes sense. I'm glad you brought up that point because it's not something I thought about it. And now, in the context of this conversation, I recognize that doctor does come from a place, feels like a place of not only authority but care. And healthcare provider sounds a little more cold.
You know, I think so. And that's just a toss-off reference, but I think it is true, and I think it does speak to some basic power struggles and changes in medicine that have continued and will continue to evolve.
So you liken the hospital setting to a military setting.
Yeah.
And I think in a military setting that there's titles that these officers have to instill order amongst
yes.
subordinates. Do you think that titles in the healthcare setting affect the physician-patient relationship?
So there are very, very much those hierarchical titles and roles, at least in teaching hospitals, are very much intact. So there's the attending physician, the chief resident, the junior resident, the intern, the medical student. It's very clearly defined. So the second part of your question was, how does that impact patient care? I suppose I can see both sides. I think that when people walk into the room, it's like, I'm Dr. So-and-so in the white coat, and that's off putting and cold. And, but I also think that sometimes patients want reassurance, want the sense that they are being, they want to understand who is who, and who has the final say, and they want that clarity, because one of the problems with being a patient, among many, is that it's bewildering. You walk into a completely different world, you have all these people who are dressed often similarly talking to you about different things, and you have no way of sort of knowing up and down. And so I think casting aside titles, I think it may be a little more complex than some say. I think there's some use to be had in there as well.
Do you think medicine was always this way, or has it gotten worse in recent years? And if it has, what effect do you think this corporatization of healthcare has had on it?
So, I think in terms of the distance and detachment, absolutely, that's always been there. I mean, or if anything, was worse in the past than it is now. I think it has become a little more organized. I mean, the corporatization is something that is a newer phenomenon and a big topic. But I will say that often the motivation seems to be more on the corporate model of revenue streams and less on what we normally conceive of as the mission of medicine, which is making people better.
There was a hand down here. She's not putting it up very far, so I don't think you're seeing it right now.
I mean, I was wondering, I know historically doctors have been mostly in a male career path, and nurses being up to changing. And I was wondering if gender roles maybe are forming physician culture, since we usually think, you know, the church general men are more distant and less emotional.
Yeah.
Women have this permission, you know, so down on the being.
These become very complicated and potentially controversial. I will say that I'm old enough that when I started off as a medical student, the number of my attendings, for example, when I was an intern or whatever, they were disproportionately male. And now, half of my colleagues are women. The other night I was working in the emergency room. It's a busy emergency room. It has more than 100,000 visits a year. And every doctor in the ER on that night, except for me, was a woman. Which is, I noticed it. I mean, I wouldn't have noticed the corollary probably years back. So I would say that I think there has probably been some changes that we don't maybe not be entirely aware of. But I also think that there probably hasn't been as many changes as people would expect. That the same issues still apply. That the same kind of hierarchies, it's interesting to see that in many cases, at least in my view, it truly doesn't matter whether the physician is female or male. In terms of action as well as, it really doesn't matter very much. I don't know if that, what I mean by matter is the behaviors are different.
I was going to say that the culture might be shaped by its history, that kind of
profession.
There's like the historic culture,
but like,
also just.
Absolutely. And I mean, these are subtle and profound differences at the same time. And so, but the rapid influx of women into medicine has not made medicine kinder. That I can see in dramatic ways.
Not
that I suspect, but. Okay. Yeah. It's hard for me to see the changes. It depends on how they make it so clear. But
I'll make sure you have a question.
Yeah, I'm interested to hear your opinion on the fairly new phenomenon of pharmaceuticals marketing directly to patients. Do you see that as empowering for patients? Now they know what
I strongly feel the latter. I think it's appalling. It's manipulative. It's disingenuous. Because doctors don't have nearly as much of a role in the, say the price of a drug or, you know, all of this, do you think it develops a sort of indifference on the part of healthcare professionals?
Absolutely. It's an abstraction. When you write a prescription, you have no idea how much that drug costs, or you order a test, you have no idea how much. Order a CAT scan, you have no idea it's going to cost a couple thousand dollars. I mean, you sort of do, but not really. So the decision-making has been removed from cost considerations to the point where most physicians honestly don't even think about that when they order tests, or not don't think that much about it at any rate. So yes, no question. Yes.
So coming back to the other half of your job is being a writer, novelist, and in doing that you're building characters. Do you find that practice of your writing and building characters feeds into your questioning possibly of the patients that come in and your ability to diagnose compared to other your colleagues that don't write?
You know, I like to say that this gives me some confidence. The answer is no. I mean, I don't feel any even slightly better, you know, better than any of this than my colleagues. I mean, not at all. You know, I think that writing and making sense of things and pursuing the arts and whatever it may be is a great thing in and of itself. But I'm not pretending for a second or deluding myself that it makes me better at my job as a doctor. And honestly, I think they're separate things. I know that's not the answer that a lot of people kind of want to hear.
All right, I'm going to ask one last question.
All right.
So that's to ask, how many of you out here are pre-meds or going into a
science?
That's
a good question.
So for these folks, Frank, given your path into medicine and how you got there, give me two or three basic insights you would want somebody to tell you about before you started that work.
Okay. So you can become a physician or an allied health person or any, you know, get somebody working in medicine. You don't need to be a biology major or a science major. You don't have to be. If you want to be, great, but you can do a lot of other things too. There's no reason you can't pursue other things and at the same time go to medical school or nursing school or whatever else you want. So you're not as limited as you perhaps think at this stage. So in terms of pre-med stuff, most of what you're learning is an ordeal. It's difficult. It's designed that way. It's designed to be hard because that's what's being tested as much as the material that you're learning. So that's what medical schools want to see. They want to see someone who works hard, really wants this. And finally, there's a lot of things to do in this world. Medicine's one of them, but there are many things to do that are satisfying and interesting. And so you shouldn't. I always tell young people, you guys' age who are either in college thinking about medicine, a lot of times people have a lot of family pressure on them. They've chosen this field because the family wants them to, or they feel like they should want them to. And I would say, would be like.
And on that note, I think we will wrap it up. Thank you so much.
Yeah. You want to bring? What? You guys are bringing? What? You guys are bringing? I'd like to stand next to you. Take your time. This is how I'm supposed to
be. Hi. How are ya?
Like, a lot of times I'll be studying in the hallway here.
Thank you.
All right.